I came to believe that Lincoln and Grant had a kind of a mutual admiration society. They admired each other greatly, and they didn't spend a lot of time together. They met several times in the White House. They met once at City Point. They were both Western men. They didn't stand on pomp and circumstance. Grant wasn't the best dressed man, neither was Abraham Lincoln, but they sort of understood each other.
So Julia, Ulysses Grant's wife from the slave state of Missouri, and Mary Todd Lincoln, of course, Abraham Lincoln's wife from the slave state of Kentucky, you would figure that they might have forged a bond, but in fact, it was the opposite. Mary Todd was not easy to get along with. She was very jealous of anybody she felt that was a woman that Lincoln had any interest in at all. And in fact, Julia turned down the invitation to be in Ford's Theater the night that Lincoln was assassinated because she did not get along with Mary Todd Lincoln. Instead, they were on a train up to see their family.
After Appomattox, Grant retained his position as general-in-chief, and his headquarters were in Washington, D.C. And it must be said that he didn't find peace there, because what the country was witnessing was a great wrangle, really, between President Andrew Johnson and the Republicans in the Congress over the question of Reconstruction. President Johnson had adopted a fairly lenient policy regarding the former slaveholders and pretty much adopted a program that would put them more or less back into power.
Grant was very concerned during the presidency of Andrew Johnson that the Civil War was being lost, that Reconstruction was not protecting the rights of African Americans, and he felt that he had to run for president to preserve the freedoms won for African Americans in the South.
There are a number of things that Grant talked about in his inaugural address. One was he wanted to make it a healing kind of message to the American people, that we really all ought to work together again. We still were the problems of Reconstruction, and he said we ought to tackle those problems without prejudice of section, without hate, without ill will. We all ought to sort of link arms together and realize that we're all in this together and see what we can do to move the country forward. He advocated ratification of the 15th Amendment, and in just looking ahead to his presidency, within a year, it was ratified.
Another major achievement of the Grant administration was using federal authority to protect African Americans from the white supremacists in the South, and that was incredibly important. There was thousands and thousands of victims of this violence, and Grant saw it as an infringement of their rights.
So Congress and Grant in 1870 created the Department of Justice. And along with that, it created a new office called Solicitor General. Benjamin Bristow from Kentucky was the first Solicitor General of the United States.
When Grant selected him, Bristow was but 38 years of age. He was a Kentucky native. He was called a Blue Jay, which meant someone who was a Union sympathizer, but probably living in a more Confederate part of the state of Kentucky.
And in that position, he was the government's chief litigator. And he was a very, very good lawyer. And he helped fight against the Ku Klux Klan. Bristow stayed there a few years, retired into private practice for a while. And then in 1874, in the spring of 1874, Grant brought him back into the administration as Secretary of the Treasury. And probably the most important thing that Bristow did as Secretary of the Treasury was his fight against the so-called whiskey ring. Bristow noticed that there was some discrepancy between production figures that he came in possession of regarding the production of whiskey in the country and the amount of revenue the government was collecting on whiskey. And there was a great disparity, and so he launched a series of raids that basically shut down many of these distilleries. Many people were arrested. He sort of defeated the whiskey ring in this sense.
One of the other things that is unknown about Grant was his commitment to land conservation. In 1872, he set aside thousands of acres in northwest Wyoming called Yellowstone as the first national park.
After 8 years in the White House, Grant was ready to leave. It had been a time when he had had some major triumphs, some disappointments, but also a great deal of criticism had come his way.
As Grant was leaving the White House, his son said that he was very excited. He wanted to travel. It was something that was always a passion of his, and he wasn't really able to indulge in anything. He was too busy throughout his career to indulge in any of his, you know, personal pursuits. And so finally, he was able to, and he went on what became a two-year round-the-world trip, spending time in Europe, the Middle East, and India and Asia.
He comes home, there's no presidential pension. He's got to figure out a way to make some money.
His son, in 1880, joined a firm with a man named Ferdinand Ward. It was a brokerage concern. Eventually, they convinced General Grant, the ex-president, to join them in this as kind of a silent partner, and he put in a great deal of his own money. It turned out to be, in essence, what later people would call a Ponzi scheme. Grant thought he was a millionaire, and really he was virtually penniless.
And Grant comes home that day to tell Julia that between the two of them, they have $131 to their name. They've been completely wiped out, nothing. He bites into a summer peach and has this terrible pain in his throat. That fall, he does a biopsy. The biopsy shows that Grant has cancer. Grant starts out to write his memoirs. Pretty soon he's struggling. The doctors ask him, while he's writing his memoirs, he's dying of cancer, to go to the Adirondacks, where the air is much cooler, and maybe this will be better for his health than staying in New York.
10 days before Grant died, Buckner came and visited Grant at his cabin at Mount McGregor, New York.
Simon Bolivar Buckner is a wonderful son of Kentucky who Grant got to know at West Point as a classmate.
One of the prominent Confederate generals, later on governor of Kentucky. And Grant's wife, Julia, asked that Buckner be a pallbearer in his funeral in New York City.
By early 1885, Grant can no longer speak. He now is writing notes to his doctor. One of them is so poignant. Grant writes to the doctor and says, "I realize with every sentence I write, I'm driving another nail into my coffin." Grant finishes his memoirs 3 days before he dies. His doctor said he only lived so he could complete the memoirs. There's a funeral procession in New York with 1.5 million people, and in what will ultimately become Grant's tomb, Grant is memorialized there.